Okay, hi, good morning, everyone. Good, very nice Sunday to everyone. Okay, today I'm here actually. Yeah, thank you, Nature Society, the Education Committee, Gloria, for inviting me to actually give me this opportunity to share about our marine life in Singapore, but particularly intertidal. So there are so much things for me to share actually, but for today, I'm just going to be just focusing on just intertidal because I also dive. And of course, I will see different things when I, you know, different kind of marine life when I go diving. But when I go intertidal, I will see different type of marine life. But then also intertidal, I have been doing intertidal for like almost 20 years. Almost every shore, okay? I can't say all, but I say many, many shore, okay? Having this opportunity to join Miss Ria Tan from WAH Singapore, that I actually get to visit a lot of shore that are otherwise so-called not accessible to most people, but I did get that opportunity to do so. And lots of photographs. And I really don't know what to share today initially because I have got so much photo. So today I'm just going to focus on initially just one shore, all right? A shore that every one of you should be very familiar with. And of course, be it good or bad, lately there was a lot of so-called news on this shore. Okay, it is none other than Changi Shore, all right? Changi is really, really full of life, okay? Changi Beach and Changi Seashore is the long stretch. It's really, really full of life. And today, all the photos and it's still, it's only like maybe like only a certain, maybe 10, 20% of all the photo I have, I got still a lot from Changi Shore, but I can't share everything today. If I share, I probably need to ask Gloria for 3 hours to 4 hours. All right. So I only have 30 minutes. I am going to jump right in. So how many of you have been on an intertidal before? Great. I mean, for those who have been on the intertidal, I'm sure you actually enjoy it. And if better still is to actually go and best to actually go for all this shore, but with a so-called experienced guide. The thing is, for Changi, like Punggol, you know, all this East Coast, you can actually go on yourself. And I mean, you can actually go and enjoy the shore by yourself, just do self-exploration. But what I would advise is you have to prepare yourself and then keep yourself safe, all right? Because we really want the young people, okay, to understand that we in Singapore, we really, really do have a lot of wonderful and fascinating marine life all around us. You don't have to be a diver. You don't need to go diving. You can actually enjoy all this, all right? So how do we prepare ourselves for intertidal exploration? Those who have been there, you probably know, okay? But those who are new, have not yet to do, yeah, here are some tips for you, right? Okay, most important, a camera, all right? Because you are not going to take anything. You're not going to take anything other than photograph, okay? So take nothing but photograph, keep nothing but memory. So do not collect anything, do not take anything, okay? It's actually for your own safety, okay? We try not to touch, okay, whatever, especially if you are unsure, you don't touch. Certain things may look the same, but they actually can be dangerous, all right? Dress appropriately and comfortably because, you know, it's outdoor, okay? Best to wear long pants and shoes. Footwear, very important. Footwear, covered footwear. Do not wear slipper. Do not wear flip-flop because those are... It does not protect your foot, all right? So be very, very careful about... We see a lot of people, you know, they they go to, they say, oh, we go to the beach, come, let's go to the beach, wear slipper. But then for intertidal, you are going to walk into the home of this furry animal, and then they can get defensive, all right? So because they have to protect their home, the humans are coming, you know, and then sometimes we accidentally can destroy their home. So they have to protect and defend their home. Therefore, they may attack, all right? Yeah, so we will have to be careful. And then we, okay, the other thing. Okay, lately there's a lot of all this news on the social media. Yes, you definitely don't need all these things. You don't need a pail, you don't need your tongs, you don't need your whatever, scoop and then go and dig and go and collect. You don't have to, unless you bring your pail to go and build sandcastle. Otherwise, don't need to bring pail to go and collect any animals, all right? Because you put all the animals together in one pail, they may not like each other, all right? And then if you bring them home, worse, okay? Because you bring them home, they may not, because they you bring them out of their environment, out of their own comfort of their home, and they will not be, they cannot adapt. They may die, okay? So do not bring any animal home and thinking that you can keep them as pet. All right, you see, even, okay, recently there was this news about this marine biologist. Even a marine biologist, very experienced, wear proper booty, still can get stung by a stingray. So what if you actually wear slippers? Isn't it worse? So think about it, all right? She wore proper footwear and she still can get injured. So think about it, okay? So that's why to minimize your injury, or best is no injury if you are careful, all right? Safety first, all right? Okay, now let us start with our first group of animals, all right? This one, Changi Beach, they are everywhere, okay? The one on the top, those on the top, they are called the warty sea cucumber. And then the one below are the tawny sea cucumber. So this pinky little sea cucumber, unlike those sea cucumber that we eat, they are very, very colorful, very pretty to look at. But yes, you also don't want to touch them. Sometimes they are all over the seagrass, everywhere. Every step you walk, you actually can see them. Okay, so just take photo like what I did. Okay, just take photo. You don't have to pick them up. Okay, you don't have to. Do not touch them, because sometimes what happens is they can actually shoot out like some toxin. And then you won't die, but you see, if you may get allergy. So when you get allergy, it's really not a very nice feeling, because you will get itchy and then you will start scratching and all those things. So best is do not touch them. Okay, when we touch them, we may even injure them. All right. Okay, come, let me show you. Okay, sea cucumber, as you can see just now. Okay, this one is tawny sea cucumber extending its tentacle to actually like ready for feeding. So you look at this one. Yeah, see, they extend it out, and then this is, yeah. So you see, this is the intertidal water. They are still submerged in water, but very shallow water. That's why we all call that intertidal. Intertidal is when the tide becomes so low, then all the water seems to be like disappear from the seashore, and we can actually walk all the way out, you know, to extend the lab. All right. Okay, wait. Let me. This one. Okay. Next one. Sorry. Okay, here. So more sea cucumber. Okay. By the way, all the photos here are taken by me. All the photos here are taken from Changi Seashore. The whole entire stretch of Changi, from like, you know, the entire stretch. Okay, so they are all different parts of Changi, but then all this one. So we have the very colorful one. These are the sea apple. So you notice that all the sea cucumber, they all have got what you call it, all the tentacles. These are feeding tentacles, right? So you see all very colorful. And then of course we have got like some boring color. Okay, the remarkable sea cucumber. And then the one on the top, on the bottom right. On the bottom right, this is a very common one. Well, I wouldn't say very common, but it's common enough that we all see it. But then now almost everything is uncommon because due to so-called habitat loss. Okay, this is called a garlic bread sea cucumber. It looks like a loaf of garlic bread. All right. So you see the very colorful one, the sea apple, the one on the two on the extreme left. Okay. The two on the extreme left. This one is it can actually this one is toxic. So you don't want to touch them also. Okay. Sometimes they say animal, the more colorful they are, actually the more dangerous they are. So sometimes you see very colorful, you look at them, they look very nice, but you may really don't want to touch them at all. Okay, remember, do not pick up anything, just take photo like what I did. All right. Okay, so the one on the left, what is that? Anyone can tell me? Is it a sea cucumber? Okay, this is not a sea cucumber, okay? This one look like, you know, just not from like the photo you see earlier. This is actually a sea pen. This is a flowery sea pen. Right. They are also sea pen. Pen as a P-E-N, sea pen. All right. So the sea pen, these are like the one, the white color one on your right hand side. Can stink, so they when you touch them, sometimes you can get some irritation in your hand if you actually touch them. And then but then you see, when to us, right, we touch them, we may get itchy, we get irritation, but then this sea pen can be a home to some animal too. So we don't remove them, because when we remove all these animals, we are removing somebody's home. So here, if you look at the bottom right, okay, you actually, can you see my cursor? Okay, there is actually, the one previous. Okay, there's actually a brittle sea star here. Okay, a brittle star here. So there's a brittle star here. And so this is a porcelain crab. Okay, these are not true crab, but then this one, we always find them, you can easily find them living in the sea pen, all right? So you see the sea pen may not be, you may not want to touch it because, you know, it can give you some irritation, but to this little guy here is their home. All right, you will always see them. You can see that I have got nowhere to go. All right, this little guy, this porcelain crab have nowhere to go, so then they have to look for another sea pen. All right, this crab, cute, right? Very cute, right? Okay. This crab is called a, anybody know? Anybody know what is this crab? Okay, this is a juvenile. This is a juvenile, it's a baby. Okay, you look at this little this is a box crab, by the way, B-O-X, B-O-X. You look at this little shell here, okay? This shell is actually just a clam shell. So now, if we remove, we will say, this clam is so beautiful. This clam shell, all this shell, you know, there are people we used to like collect seashells and all those things. Do not collect all these things, because it is also like a home, a resting area for some of the animal. This box crab here is very small. You look at the size of the clam. The clam is about a size of maybe slightly bigger than a 50-cent coin. Then you look at that crab inside that. So you can imagine how tiny this little box crab is. Okay, this box crab is so tiny. So it sits on that little clam. I mean, the clam is already dead, but then it just feels safe. Okay, so yeah. So sometimes when we remove all these things, we are really removing some furniture and all those things from the home of somebody, okay? And these are belongs to this animal there on the intertidal mud flat. All right, here, more crab. Okay, the one on the top right, top left, okay, is a moon crab. It's one of my favorite crab. It is so fast. It always burrow into the mud very fast. Okay, so it's quite difficult to take photo of them, but I actually look at the legs and all those things. They can swim really fast. You know, when they have this kind of paddle-like leg, right? They really can swim. All right. The one on the top right is definitely a swimming crab. So they are very slim and they really cut through the water and swim very fast. All right, then the one on the bottom, this is a thunder crab, the black one. Okay, the thunder crab is making friend with the sea cucumber. It's making friend with the sea cucumber here. Oh, the thunder crab, you look at this crab, you don't go and try to, you know, like dig it out from, because it likes to hide in between like crevices and a rock and all those things. So what happened is you do not want to go and like you know, try to actually pull it out or whatsoever, because when it snap your finger, they say only when the sound of the thunder and lightning, the thunder, then this crab will let go. That means it needs a very loud noise to actually let go of the thing. So that means it is very painful. Ouch. Okay, very, very painful. Okay, the one on the bottom right, right? This is a horn-eyed ghost crab. Now, this ghost crab, right? They always burrow very, very, very deep, okay, into the mud flat. And it's so difficult to take their photo. I am so happy. This is about like one of those few time that I managed that I have to run very fast and chase, and then or I just squat there and wait, and I finally managed to get a photo of this ghost crab. Because yeah, that's why they're called ghost crab. They are so difficult, you always cannot see them one. Okay, yeah, now you see them, now you don't. All right, right here, I think a lot of you will know what are these. Okay, this is horseshoe crab. Now, by the way, horseshoe crab are not true crab. Huh? They are called crab, but they are not exactly crab. They doesn't belong to the same group of animal as like our usual the crustacean. They are actually more closely related to scorpion. And they have been around for like more than 4 million years old, and they are like really a dinosaur. Okay, they are probably longer than dinosaur. Okay, until today they have not changed, they are still like this. Okay, now in the whole world there are actually 4 different species of horseshoe crab. Singapore have got 2. Okay, Singapore have got the mangrove horseshoe crab and this is the coastal horseshoe crab. Now this coastal horseshoe crab is bigger. The mangrove horseshoe crab is smaller. And this coastal horseshoe crab usually is much bigger. You want to know how big they are? Okay, the next slide, you will know how big this. Just say. And remember, if you go to the seashore, okay, or you go for your intertidal walk, and you happen to see a horseshoe crab, remember, do not, okay, please remember, okay, remember, do not hold up the horseshoe crab by its tail, okay, the tail is called a telson, so you never hold a horseshoe crab and bring it up by its tails, okay, so because when you break this horseshoe crab, right, the tail is not a weapon. If you break the tail, poor thing. They cannot upright themselves. They cannot turn themselves. If the wave wash them and then they overturn, so then they cannot turn themselves back up. Then they will slowly starve to death because they cannot feed. All right. Want to know how big is this coastal horseshoe crab? That big. See the hand? This is the hand of an adult, a friend of mine. And look at this one. It's bigger than an adult hand. Okay? Bigger than a... So it's almost like the size of my face, you know? Like if I take this whole thing, I cover, right? Then, yeah, the cover of my whole face. Okay? The biggest horseshoe crab in Singapore, the biggest so-called coastal horseshoe crab I have measured is across here, from here to here, the carapace, is about 28 centimeter. All right? So it's very big. All right, here are some shells, okay? They all look so pretty. The one on the top left is actually a spiral melangina. Then the one on the top right, okay, the very colorful orangey one, that is a nombre velute. It's one of my favorite so-called sea marine snail. All right, it's huge. Sometimes it can be quite big. It's like as big as my fist. And I have to say that very sadly, okay, a few years ago, every time I go to Changi, I see them everywhere. Almost every step I walk, I see one. Now when I go, I have to walk very far before I see one. Sometimes the entire trip, I don't even see one because I guess people are collecting, but it's okay. We hope that they will return. Yeah. All right. And then below, all these are all our so-called the bivalve, the clam. So they look very pretty, very beautiful design. But remember, do not collect any shell because they could be home to some animal, which I'm going to share with you right now. You know, the spiral melangina and the nombre velute is a favorite home for hermit crab. Okay, hermit crab like to look for the empty shell. Okay, they like to look for the empty shell, and then they will carry it as and just to protect themselves, because the hermit crab, they don't have a hard shell to protect themselves. So they don't have. So what they do is they just like so-called, yeah, like robber. So they just go and steal whatever. Actually, not really. I would say, because it's already empty. So it's like first come, first serve. So nobody take, right? I take first. Okay. So sometimes you see here, on the top one, you have the spiral melangina. Then after that, you know, this other one on the right-hand side, you got a different kind of shell. And then the one on the bottom got another different shell, you know, with very, very, you know, so you see all the shells are different. So for hermit crab, this is the orange striped hermit crab. They actually as long as their sign fit, then they just go in. Then what happened is that when they continue to grow and then they become too big for their shell, they will actually change. So they will upgrade. So they will upgrade like from a 3-room, then they will upgrade to a 5-room flat. Then after that, they upgrade to condo. Then one day they will upgrade. Then they get bigger and bigger the shell. They will keep on looking for bigger and bigger shell. Then they will go for the nombre velute, and then they will look for like that one is like bungalow, okay? Okay, the next group is I think all the kids love this. Okay, y'all will like this because this is our sea star. Okay, but then of course they all belong to this group of animal. Okay, called the echinoderm. So now, I'm going to share with you a few different type within this whole big group, and then they are actually a little bit different. Okay. Five of the sea star here, okay, Yeah, people like to call them starfish, but try not to because they are not fish. Okay. Yeah. All right. So the top three and then the bottom. Okay. The first one, that one is the biscuit star. And this one is my favorite, the one in the center, the pink color one. That one is a knobbly sea star. And this knobbly sea star, look at it. Look like got chocolate chips, right? Look, chocolate chips cookie, right? Oh, my friend. So remember, do not collect them. Okay, do not. Just go there. See them. Visit them. Say hi to them, take photo, and then you keep your photo, okay? And then the one on the top right, okay, top right, these are painted star, okay? These are painted star, and then the one bottom also painted star, okay? And then after that, you have got, another one. I think that one is either a cake or a biscuit, all right? This one is quite big. And there's a few here, right? These are not the sea star. These are called the brittle star. Brittle. So brittle, yes. They are really brittle because they are so thin. Okay, their leg and their arms are you one, right? The arms are all very fat, very strong. Five arms, okay, all very strong. But then this one is also fun, but it's five skinny arms, you know. So it can break easily if you don't know how to handle them. You don't know how to handle them, and then you just you can actually break them, and then yeah, then but then to be very honest, sea star, they break one arms, right? They can regenerate and they can grow back again, but we all don't want to injure them just for the fun of that. Okay, look here. What is this? Like I say, right? Animals are so interesting. Okay, they actually like hitchhike on each other. Okay, like just now you saw the porcelain, that crab, right? That live in the sea pen. Here you see, look at this. This is our chocolate chips, the knobbly sea star, right? And look at all this, right? These are actually the brittle star. Okay, so many baby brittle star, you know, actually all like hitchhiking, you know. So when this big pink knobbly move a little bit, so everybody all like hike, like hitchhike, yeah? Everybody all move together. So they, because they're so tiny, very easily people just step on it, they all die. So they just hitchhike on a bigger star. All right. And then, yeah. So, okay. Here some more different kind of so-called group. Okay. You kind of know them, but same, but yet different. All right. The first one here is actually a sand dollar. Okay. So you see, can you see the arm one? Okay. It's round. Okay. So it don't have that five. But it's still five arms. One, two. So that is how close it to, you know, this is called a sand dollar. Yeah, a sand dollar. And then not all sea star have got five arms. Okay, these sea star here have got eight arms. Yes. Say eight, okay? So got three extra arms, okay? This is Lucidia, eight arm sea star. All right. So they this one got eight arms, and then the one on the extreme right, of course, is what I shared with you just now. This is the brittle star. All right. Okay. The next one, same. It's the same group of animal, okay, but they are not sea star, okay? These are called feather star, all right? So feather star are not sea star. They are actually, they belong to another family called, they are actually crinoids, Okay, crinoid. So they have got so many arms, and then they actually can swim. All right, they actually can swim. So they have so many. So I have when I go diving, I actually see them swimming, and it's so beautiful because they look like a flower, and then they actually like floating, you know, swimming. But they the same thing. Okay, every feather, right, is also very very fragile, very delicate, and it also can break easily. So sometimes and they like to attach themselves to some sea fan and other things. So you don't go and use your hand and pluck them out from the sea fan because you will just break them. All right. Okay, I'm going to show you. Oh, this one's so poor thing. Because, okay, this is a feather star, but because there's no water, look at it. Look at how looks so pitiful, right? Because no water, so the feather all so limpy, okay? So it needs some water, so... So life on the intertidal is so tough. Look at the wave coming and then just hit them and then you're like, ouch, you know, ouch, you know. So then they move, and then after another wave come, ayo, I tell you, so poor thing, ayo, you see, so poor thing. But then I tell you, all the animals on the intertidal mud flat are very tough one. They will survive, okay? Even though it's so tough like that, okay? Yeah, so they will survive. Okay, this one, these are what? Sea urchin. All right, so all these, okay, every single photo here are taken from Changi Beach. So if you have been there and you say, how come you saw so many things and I did not? That's because you don't know how to find them, okay? How to find animals, you must understand their habitat. So for example, sea urchin. Okay, they like to hang around, you know, like this Synopsis, the yellow one, they like seagrass. So you go to seagrass, meadow, right? You are likely to find them, all right? So you must know where they are, and then it would be very easy to look for them. So you don't just go walk anywhere and then say, oh, I want to look for this, I want to look for that. You have to understand. Some of the animal like rocky area. Some they hang around the coral rubbles. Some hang around the seagrass meadow. So depending on what you're looking for, you go to the habitat and then you look for them. All right. And then yes, that's why I say do not remove anything. It's like you take something and then after that you walk. You put in your pail. Then you walk 1 kilometer down the beach and then you saw some rocky area and then you go and put it there. They don't like it because you say, where are my seagrass? Okay, that's like got no seagrass already. So it's so poor thing, okay? This one is another sea urchin. This is one of my favorite sea urchin. I don't see them very often as compared to the Synopsis and the black sea urchin. This one, very interesting. You look at it, the very colorful, very nice. Okay, and then this sea urchin is called the pencil sea urchin. Pencil, like our pen and pencil. Look at all the spines sticking out. Okay, every single one look like a pencil or maybe a straw also look like straw. All right, okay, very interesting. Okay, I'm going to show you a video of how they move. They move so slowly, so slowly. Very, very slow.
Lisa, I think you can skip the video because it's very laggy. So maybe just stick to the photos.
Very laggy?
Yeah, very laggy. So can you just stick to the photos? Yeah, don't show any videos.
Oh, okay, can.
Cannot see anything. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Okay, so the next group. Slug. Sea slug, marine slugs, okay? So, this big one is actually called a mellow. It's huge. Look at the hand, okay? It's as big as a palm. It's huge and heavy, This one also found on Changi, but I won't tell you where, because so that nobody can go and find it, because this one is critically, this one is endangered, ah. Okay, this mellow. And then below we have got the sea hare. Okay, it belongs to the slug family. And then the other two cute one. Okay, the other one, these are called the side gill slug, right? Now you look at the one on the extreme, right. Okay, there's two of them. Usually when you see one, right, they like to hang out in group. So usually you don't see them as one. You'll probably see two, or you see like a group together. And that time when I saw it, there was like three of them together. So cute. Look at the face. Looks so comical, like cartoon like that, right? Okay, this is actually a sea slug. And it's the size is about half my palm size. Okay. Yeah. Half of my palm. Yeah. Okay. Sometimes it's smaller, sometimes it's slightly bigger. Okay, so this is a side gill sea slug. Okay, then we have got other animals. Okay. Most often overlooked is this one, okay? The one on the top left hand. Top left hand, this one is called, it's actually a sea squid. Nothing so special about it, but so a lot of people actually, just that don't think that it's very interesting enough. But then if you look properly, like it actually is like that. Yeah, like, so we call this a thumb, you know, your thumb. Okay, thumbs up sea squid. Okay, because it looked like it's like all the sea squid, it got like this one, it's like got the thumb showing up. Okay, so yeah, you see, so this is your hand and this is your thumb, right? This one is a soft coral. Okay, this the one in the middle, this is a soft coral, looks so pretty, right? Look like flower. And of course, also another of my favorite animal, seahorse. But then I have to tell you, seahorse you don't see all the time. I have problem finding them lah. So yeah. So I whenever time, every time if I get to see them, I'm so happy, so excited. All right. So yeah, of course, when I go diving, I see them, but intertidal, okay, different species. Some live like in the deep sea, some can actually survive around the intertidal area. So this is one of those who are actually in the intertidal area. So seahorse is so cute. And then you know they will always hook their tails to the seagrass, seagrass or seaweed. Okay, then they will just hang around. Yeah, because yeah. And then the one on the bottom left. Okay, that is actually a mantis shrimp. There's actually a mantis shrimp, and they are super fast too. Okay, so you have to be very, very fast, right? And then to be very honest, a lot of my photographs are taken in those very funny hours, because intertidal, right? When it's very low tide, not necessarily have to be like bright daylight. A lot of the low tide happen like 4 a.m., sometimes 3:30. Sometimes 5 a.m. in the morning. So you go out there with a torchlight, dark, and then you go and look for all this animal. All right. Okay, and then the pink color and the green one on here, these are sponge, okay? Sea sponge. And so your sponge block is real one. There is really this thing called sea sponge, okay? So that sponge block is really a sea sponge. All right? What's his name, What is the sponge? What is his name? That sponge block, the sea sponge. I know Patrick, the sea star.
SpongeBob SquarePants.
Oh, SquarePants. Yes. Yeah. His name is SquarePants. Yes. Yeah. So he is really, really a sea sponge. Okay. All right. Okay. So now this is another group of animal, anemone. Okay, here, these are carpet anemone. So carpet anemone, also you can see them in Changi. So here, different part of Changi, I saw a very bright, purple color. And then usually they are like green like this. And then this what you call it, this carpet anemone. Anemone is a home to this anemone shrimp. So this anemone shrimp, so you see, so here is a close-up shot of this carpet anemone and the anemone shrimp. So this is the five spot anemone shrimp. So they like to hang around they actually live lah. I would say they hang around, they live on this anemone, on this carpet anemone. So if you want to go and look for them, you go to the anemone and then you knock, say, are you home? Then sometimes they will come out and greet you, but sometimes they don't. Sometimes nobody's at home. All right. And the one on the bottom, the pink color one, that one is a cerantic, okay, which is actually or otherwise known as what we call tube anemone, okay, tube anemone. So anemones, so don't touch them, okay, because they can sting you and then you get irritation, yeah, all right? Okay, this one very common, everywhere on Changi Beach, you can see them, okay? Everywhere you can see them. These are the mussel, the cream mussels. Then these are the fan clam. Oh, by the way, these are edible. Okay, these three are edible. In fact, I tell you, all the animals are edible. Some you can eat at least once. Okay, then after that, we don't know what happened to you. But then, like these three clams are basically are food lah to many people, because sometimes you go to those seafood store, they actually sell them, okay? The first one is the mussel, then the fan clam, and then the one on the extreme right, that one is a bamboo clam, okay? So all these are actually common food, okay? Common food. So in the olden days, the seashore it's very common for people to, you know, who live by the coastal area to just go to the seashore to forage for food. So last time don't have supermarket, they just go to the seashore and they forage and then they will collect all these things. But then when they collect, right, they collect what? It's just for their food. They just collect enough just for their family to eat. Then after that, yeah, so it will, then all these clam, they are not endangered, so they will just keep coming back, then they will always be there. But then of course, if for today, right, I'm not sure if it's advisable to actually go and collect to eat, because our water is not like really, really very, very clean as like compared to like 40, 50 years ago. Yeah, because now with all the industrialization, the industry, then all our water also a little bit polluted. So I'm not too sure, but I can't say that, I can't tell people say don't go and collect and eat, because there are still people eating, but I guess if they're used to it, it's fine, all right? Okay, next one. This one is flatworms, okay? All these are flatworms, all right? Flatworms. So these are, I have a lot of flatworms, but I only can show you this. Okay, because I can't show everything. Okay, I'm going to introduce Sichuan. Sichuan is a marine biologist, and then he will help. If you have any question, okay, you can ask, and then myself or Sichuan, we will try our best to answer your question. Okay, if you have any question on all the animal that I have just introduce and share with you. Okay, Sichuan, can you wave to everybody? Okay, so if you have any question, maybe some of you have already typed in some question. Gloria from the Nature Society is going to ask the question, and then, yeah, Sichuan, okay. Where is Sichuan? Oh, Sichuan is there. Sichuan has got a shark behind his wallpaper.
Okay, so the first question is, what do sea stars?
So if you want to be a marine biologist.
Sorry, say again?
What do sea stars eat?
Okay, sea stars, they eat many different things. So different sea stars, they can eat things like clams. We have one very special star, a sea star in Southeast Asia that actually eats coral. That's a very dangerous one. Yeah. It's called the crown of thorns. Yeah. And the spikes are dangerous because they are venomous. So they can hurt people. Otherwise, you get sea stars on our intertidal zone that they just sort of crawl around the sand and they pick up things from the sand. But they have a very interesting way of eating because sea stars don't have teeth. So they actually have to send the stomach out,
yeah,
dissolve their food, and then suck it back in again. All right. I hope that answers the question.
Okay. Yeah.
How about sand dollars?
The crown of thorns, we don't get to see them at the intertidal zone. Crown of thorns, we can only see them when we dive.
Are there crown of thorns in Singapore?
Yes, we can find crown of thorns in Singapore.
Okay, so is it NPARC's policy to remove them or just let them be?
I actually don't know, Lisa. What do you know? NPARC's policy?
So far, diving in Singapore, I have not seen any. It's not common. I'm sure there are, but so far, the places that I dive in Singapore, I have not seen any.
Okay. Yeah, I've only seen it in Malaysia.
Well, we can ask NPARC's later what their policy is.
Yeah, I've only seen it in Malaysia.
Yeah, just
it's not.
Okay, how about the sand dollars?
I guess it's not a major problem whereby they have to curl it or something like that. Next question.
What do sand dollars eat?
Sand dollars are a little bit like sea urchins. So if you imagine a sea urchin that's flattened, so flat like that. Sorry? Did somebody want to say something? Yes.
I just now answered, are there any dugongs in Changi?
Okay, we just take one question at a time. Okay, what do sand dollars eat, Sik Chuan?
Okay, sand dollars are like sea urchins that have flattened, and they are what we call grazers. And they have a special structure at the bottom where there's an opening which scrapes algae. So, if you could say it's a bit like a very special teeth which can scrape away the algae from the seabed. That's mostly what the sand dollars eat.
Okay. So, are there any dugongs in Changi?
There is evidence of dugongs in Changi as well as in other parts of Singapore waters, but it's not easy to see dugongs. Mostly what we see are the evidence
the feeding
from
trail.
Things like feeding trails. I think other than the last dugong that was seen many years ago, I'm not sure anyone has seen a dugong in recent years.
Okay, so are sea urchins poisonous?
Aha, all right. Interesting question. So before I go into that, there's a difference in poisonous and venomous, and we always have to explain this. So if an animal is poisonous, it means that if you eat it, you get poisoned. Mm-hmm. If an animal is venomous, it's not necessarily poisonous. A venomous animal has to bite you or sting you to get the venom inside you. So a venomous animal would be something like bees, wasps, snakes are venomous because they bite, inject the venom into you. Some sea urchins are venomous because their spines contain venom, which if you step on, then the venom gets into you. But sea urchins not every species of sea urchin, but some species of sea urchins, they're edible. So they're not poisonous.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. So
Japanese cuisine, uni, which is actually the so-called, it's part of the reproductive part of this sea urchin. they actually eat it as a delicacy. Yeah. So yeah, depending on like what trying to say, which part of the sea urchin and what type of sea urchin.
Okay. So somebody's asking which of these marine animals are endangered and what can we do to save them? Amongst what Lisa has presented.
The horseshoe crab.
The horseshoe crab is endangered. And the thing is, Singapore is in a difficult place because most of the animals are what we call vulnerable, which means that they have the possibility of becoming endangered. And that's mostly due to the fact that we keep developing our seashores, which means that these animals have no more homes. Horseshoe crabs definitely endangered, and because they have, there's many things that's happening there. So they've lost their homes because of seashore development. They have, they are actually eaten in parts of Southeast Asia, and they are very slow growing animals. They don't grow very quickly and they don't have big numbers. Although they may lay, thousands and thousands of eggs, out of that thousands of eggs, maybe about 2%, 1 to 2% survive. All right. So other animals that could be endangered, the volute that Lisa was talking about, it's not endangered, but it's getting close to it. And only because people eat it. So there's a number of different threatened. Yes, thank you. But there's a lot of marine creatures that are threatened. Some of them have become endangered simply because they're eaten. So this is something that we all have to be, we all have to think about all of this. What are we doing out there? And then there is one issue in recent times where lots of people went on to Changi and they were digging up. So this is again, going back to what Lisa said, you don't need to take your pails there. You don't need to take the animals home. You can always see the animals in the seashore. As long as you leave them there, they'll always be there. If you take them home, you will definitely be killing them. All right? So then after that, then it starts to get threatened. And then after that, it gets endangered. Okay, I hope that answered that question.
Okay, we probably can take maybe one last question. Yeah.
So, okay, there's a question. How long can all these intertidal animals survive out of the water, given that the low tide is 6 hours?
Okay. The time, 6 hours low tide doesn't mean that the tide is out for 6 hours. So what happens is that the low tide slowly goes out and slowly comes back in during those 6 hours. The animals have they have something we call a circadian rhythm, which means that they already are aware that there's a low tide and a high tide, and they have adjusted their lifestyle to take into account low tide. Most of the animals will be able to survive the low tide for as long as it is. So even what we call the spring low tides, which means the tide is lower than normal, all these animals will survive, including out in the southern shores. Coral reefs can survive at least up to 2 hours out of water. And what they do is they have ways of surviving, which means they conserve water. They either close up and conserve water by not moving around very quickly, or they are in a place where there is always like a tidal pool. So they're always somewhere wet. So very rarely does a tidal zone get completely dry. There's always a few wet spots here and there. And the animals make use of that by, in Changi, for example, it's sandy, they burrow into the sand. Once you burrow into the sand, it remains wet and damp. Also, when you burrow into the sand, you get out of the heat, so you don't overheat. All right, if you look closely next time you go out, many of the animals are actually under rocks, or they're hiding in crevices. They're hiding somewhere where there's no direct sunlight. So that takes care of water and temperature.
Okay, I have something to add. Yes, sorry, I'm a science teacher. So yes, the science teacher will answer this. okay, you know, all the kids, right, you all study adaptation, right? So this is where adaptations come in. So you see, they have, like what Sik Chuan say, they have to learn how to adapt to the condition, right? So they know they don't get water for the, so some of them, like Sik Chuan say, they will hide in the crevices under the rock to stay away from sunlight. Some, a lot of them actually will burrow. They will burrow very deep because deep in the mud is wet and moist. So that's how they actually survive those hours of so-called no water. All right? So they really adapt to the condition.
Okay. Okay, thanks everybody. Thanks Lisa for presenting and Sik Chuan for helping to answer the questions. Okay, and thanks everybody for attending. So I think we better stop the session. Okay, so have a pleasant Sunday. Okay, I'll see you at the next Found in Nature event. Okay, right. Bye-bye.
Thanks for inviting me.
You're welcome. Okay, Lisa and Sik Chuan, maybe I can talk to you all for a short while.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
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 Thanks, Lisa.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.